नमस्ते एवरीवन, टुडे वी विल सी अ न्यू चैप्टर कोऑपरेटिव सोसाइटीज। द कोऑपरेटिव मूवमेंट इज द आउटकम ऑफ इकोनॉमिक एंड सोशल इनबैलेंस क्रिएटेड बाय द इंडस्ट्रियल रिवॉल्यूशन। द इंडस्ट्रियल रिवॉल्यूशन लेड टू द डिवीजन ऑफ द सोसाइटीज इनटू कैपिटलिस्ट एंड लेबर क्लासेस। कैपिटलिस्ट स्टार्टेड एक्सप्लॉइटिंग लेबर्स एंड other weaker sections of the society for selfish gain. The weaker section started the cooperative movement to protect and promote their interest against such exploitation. Each for all and all for each and self-helping thought through mutual aid are the guiding principles of cooperation. So we can trace this cooperative movements in 18th century or 19th century, when industrial revolution came. So in industrial revolution, what happened? There is rise in industries and therefore there was increase in labor forces. And what we seen that these capitalists who are doing the business, they are started exploiting the labor class. And as labor class is huge in number, to protect their interest, what these labor classes has done? So they started a cooperative movement. So this is the beginning of cooperative societies. Now, what is the meaning of a cooperative society? A cooperative society is a form of organization wherein persons associate together voluntarily and on equal basis to further their common interest. So what is this cooperative society is all about? It is a collection of people, it is a group of people who are coming voluntarily by their own and forming a group for their common interest. For example, consumers may join hand to produce goods at cheaper rate by establishing direct contacts with manufacturers and thereby eliminates the profit of the middleman. Similarly, the people belonging to the working class may form a cooperative society to provide houses at low cost to the members. So here we are seeing some examples. In one example, we have seen that customers, they form a cooperative society and they start dealing with manufacturers so that they can purchase their requirements directly from the manufacturer, and hence the commission which a middleman enjoys is eliminated. Similarly, we have seen one more example in which people come together and form a society to provide housing facilities at a lower cost. A cooperative society is based on the principle of self-help and mutual help, and its primary motive is to render services to the member. So this is the primary objective of cooperative society. Why we are forming a cooperative society? We are forming a cooperative society, so that we will help each other and provide services to each other. Or we can say that member of the cooperative societies. Now, some popular definitions of cooperative organizations are: cooperative organization is a society which has its objectives for the promotion of economic interest of its member in accordance with the cooperative principles. So there are some principles laid down by agencies or laid down by the governments. Based on those principles, here the people are coming together, forming an organization for their benefits. The Indian Cooperative Society Act 1912. So this is as per the Indian Cooperative Society Act 1912. A cooperative society is a form of organization wherein persons voluntarily associate together as human beings on the basis of equality for the promotion of economic interest of themselves. This is as per H.C. Calvet. So we have understood in short what is a cooperative society. means. What is this? This is a group of voluntary people, a group of people who are coming together voluntarily. Voluntarily means they are coming together by their own wish. Okay, and why they are coming together? They are coming together for their common interest. A cooperative organization is an association of persons, usually of limited means, who have voluntarily joined together to achieve a common economic end. Through the formation of a democratically controlled business organizations, making equitable contributions to the capital required and accepting a fair share of risk and benefit of the undertaking. So this is international level organization. This has defined a cooperative organization in this way. Features of the cooperative society. Features means just like a human being have features, that they can walk, they have hand, they have different body parts. Similarly, what are the features of a cooperative society? So the features of the cooperative society is, first, voluntary association. Second, religious and political neutrality. Third, separate legal entity. Fourth, one man, one vote. Fifth, service motive. Sixth, registration. State control, distribution of surplus, cash trading. Okay, so we are going to discuss the features of a cooperative society on these points: voluntary association, religious and political neutrality, separate legal entity, one man, one vote, service motive, registration, state control, distribution of surplus, and cash trading. So let us see one by one. First is voluntary association. Now by name it indicates that it is a voluntary association. That means the people are coming together according to their own wish. So nobody is forcing them. A cooperative society is essentially a voluntary association of people desirous to undergo their economic status, improving their economic status through the joint action. So a cooperative society is essentially a voluntary association. It is a voluntary association of peoples or persons desirous of improving their economic status through joint actions. So they want to improve their economic status by joint actions. Everyone having a common interest is free to join a cooperative society. He can also leave the society after giving proper notice. So anyone can join the cooperative society, anyone can leave this cooperative society. He can withdraw his capital but cannot transfer his share to another person. So in cooperative society you can withdraw your capital, but you cannot transfer your share to someone else. You have to return the shares to the cooperative society. Nobody is forced to become a member of the or to continue as a member. So nobody is forced to become a member and nobody is forced to remain a member. Anyone can leave anytime. So the cooperative society is a voluntary association. Second is religious and political neutrality. Now what is religious and political neutrality? Religious and political neutrality means there is no scope for religion and politics in the cooperative society. So the membership of the cooperative society is open to all irrespective of their caste, their creed, their religion or their political affiliations. New members are always welcome to join the society. Cooperative societies represent universal brotherhood. So they represent universal brotherhood means they accept everyone. Separate legal entity. After registration, a cooperative society becomes a distinct body irrespective of its member. So, after registration, cooperative society becomes a separate entity. It can own property and make contract in its own name. It becomes an autonomous and self-governing organization. One man, one vote. So, have you understood what is separate legal entity? Means once you register your cooperative society, it becomes a separate entity like a company. Okay, and it can make its decisions, it can make contracts, it can purchase properties and do business. One man, one vote. Every member has one vote, irrespective of the number of shares held by him. Each person holding more shares cannot dictate terms. The organization of cooperative society is democratic and all members have the equal voice in its management. So, this is a very important thing. One man, one vote. So, it indicates that if you have more shares of the cooperative society, then also you cannot dictate. Okay, so everyone have equal chance, okay, to put his voice in the cooperative society. Service motive. The primary aim of the cooperative society is to provide service to its member. Its motto is each for all and all for each. Okay, so what is the motive of cooperative society? The motive of cooperative society is to help each other, to provide benefit to each other. However, a cooperative society may earn some profit for the benefit of its members. Registration. Registration of cooperative society is compulsory. Registration is done by the registrar of the cooperative society. So, registration, it is compulsory to register the cooperative society. Means you all come voluntarily and form an organization. It is not called as cooperative society until and unless you register it. So, registration is compulsory for cooperative societies. State control. Government exercises regulations and control over cooperative societies to ensure healthy growth of these societies. So, state control. Government agencies, they are controlling the function of society. Okay, so it is not that key we form a society and nobody is going to control us, whatever we want we can do. It is not like that. Government is there, government is controlling our activities. And which government? It is state government. So, state government controls the activities of a society so that the society grow in a healthy manner. Distribution of surplus. The profit of cooperative societies are distributed not in proportion to the share of capital contributed by the member. Rather, it is based on the volume of business transacted by a member with the cooperative society. A member with a small capital contribution can receive a relatively large share in profit if he has a large number of transactions with the society. A limited dividend up to 10% is distributed on the share capital. So, distribution of surplus means we have formed voluntarily one association, one cooperative society to benefit each other. Okay, and maybe with that cooperative society we are doing something, okay, by which we are earning the money. Now, once this cooperative society earns money and there is excess of money means whatever is required for running the business, there is more money coming in. Then what we do? We divide that money and give to the members of the society. Now, in what ratio we are going to give this surplus to the member? So, here it is not like ki the person who has invested more money or the person who has more share of the society will get more benefit. Actually, the benefit is based on how much business a person does with the society or how much involvement of a person is in the society. If a person is more involved, then he will get more benefit. And yes, based on share capital, there is another benefit which is called dividend, and this dividend is generally less than 10%. So this is how the profit is distributed. This is how the surplus is distributed. Cash trading. Generally, no cash, no credit is granted to the member. Generally, no credit is granted to the members. That is, all trading is on the cash basis. So cash trading is there. So these are the features of a cooperative society. So I hope we are very much clear with the features of cooperative society. The features are voluntary association, that means people are coming together according to their wish, okay, to improve their life. Second, religious and political neutrality. There is no rule for religion and politics in the cooperative society. Anyone belonging to any religion can join the cooperative society. Separate legal entity. We have seen that after registration, this cooperative society becomes a separate legal entity. It can purchase, sell, it can do any kind of business, okay, in the name of that cooperative society. One man, one vote. So here we have seen that the voting right or the right to put their voice is based on the number of members. It is not based on how much share you own. So for each person, there is one voting right. Okay, and service motive. So cooperative societies, they are built to help each other. So their motive is to do service, okay, rather than to earn profit. Profit is their secondary motive. Okay, primary motive is to give service. Registration, here we have seen that registration is compulsory in formation of cooperative society. State control, yes, we have seen that there is a state government who is regulating the functioning of the cooperative society and distribution of surplus. So here we have seen that the surplus is distributed based on the involvement of a member in the society. And finally, all the tradings are done in cash. Now, here let us discuss the distinction between a cooperative society and a joint stock company. So here we, as we are seeing the features, as the meaning of the cooperative society, we are understanding that they are little bit similar to the joint stock company, which we have already studied. So, but it is not completely the same as our companies. There is a difference between a company and cooperative society. Let us understand it one by one. First, we will understand it on the basis of basic object. What is the basic object of cooperative society? What is the basic object of a joint stock company? So basic object, the primary objective of a cooperative society is to provide service, whereas the company seeks to earn a profit. So this is the basic objective. The basic objective of cooperative society is to provide service, whereas the basic objective of a company is to earn a profit. This does not mean that a cooperative society does not earn profit or a company does not render the service to the society. It simply means that all the activities of cooperative society are guided by the service motive and profit are incidental to this objective. On the other hand, the activities of the company are inspired by profit making and service rendered to the society are incidental to profit motive. So what it indicates that our main objective is to help each other. Our main objective is to provide service to the society. Okay, in cooperative society, our main objective is to provide service to the society. And while we are providing service to the society, we are earning, we are getting profit. So profit is coming, but our main objective is to give service. Whereas in case of joint stock company, they go for profit. Their first objective is to get profit. And while getting profit, they are providing service to the society. How they are getting profit? So when you serve the society, from society you will get profit, but the main objective was to get profit in case of joint stock company. Now let us discuss number of members. Now this is a very important term. You should know how many members minimum and maximum should be there in a cooperative society or in any other kind of organization. So for joint stock company or private partnership firms, so a minimum number of person is 7 in the public company, 2 in the private company. A cooperative requires at least 10 members. So minimum number of persons. So we have seen that if it is a public company, minimum 7 persons are required. If it is a private company, minimum 2 persons are required. But if it is a cooperative society, then at least 10 members are required. At least, we are talking about minimum number of persons. The maximum number of members is 200 in a private company and 100 in cooperative credit society. So, in case of private company, there is 200 maximum number of people and 100 for cooperative credit society. So there is no maximum limit in case of public companies and non-credit cooperative society. So here we are seeing that cooperative societies could be non-credit or credit. Okay, so we will see this difference afterwards. But for a non-credit cooperative society, the maximum number of people is unlimited. Similarly, in case of public companies, there is no maximum limit. But if the cooperative society is a credit cooperative society, then the maximum number of people is 100. What is the minimum number of people? It is 10. Right? Okay. Now, members' liability. Members' liability, this is a very important point. What is your liability? The liability of member of a company is generally limited to the face value of the shares held or the amount guarantee given by them through the Companies Act permits unlimited liability to the companies. The members of the cooperative society can opt for unlimited liability, but in practice their liability is generally limited. So here liability of the members of a company is generally limited to the face value of the shares held or the amount of the guarantee given by them. So in case of private company, whatever amount of share I have, that much is only the liability from my side, or whatever guarantee I have given, that much is the liability from my side. This is in case of companies. Now for cooperative society, so cooperative society can opt for unlimited liability. Okay, they have also limited liability, but if they want, they can go for unlimited liability. That means all the liabilities they take for their own, for their cooperative society. So in case of cooperative society, liability could be unlimited. It is the choice of members. Now membership. Membership. The membership of cooperative society is open at all time, and new members have to pay the same amount per share as old one have paid. So membership means you can join, the cooperative society at any time. And how much you have to pay? You have to just pay the amount what the old members have paid during its formation. A company, on the other hand, closes the list of members as soon as its capital is fully subscribed. People who wanted to become member later on have to buy shares at the stock exchange. So in case of company, what happens? Company, they close their membership register once their capital requirement is fulfilled. So once their capital requirement is over, okay, they close their membership. And later on, if anyone wants to become a member, then he has to purchase shares from the stock exchange. This is for company. In case of cooperative society, so you can become a member at any time. Now, management and control. The management of cooperative society is democratic, as each member has one vote and there is no system of proxy. Proxy means I ask someone else in place of mine. Okay. So, the management of the cooperative society is democratic, as each member has one vote and there is no system of proxy. Now, democratic means what? It is ruled by everyone. But everyone cannot rule, na? They will appoint some person to function, okay, that cooperative society. So, here, as in case of country, we can see that we are all appointing some persons who can do day-to-day activity. Similarly, in cooperative system also, every member has a voting right and they vote and they appoint some persons who then work for the society. So, the management of the cooperative society is democratic, as each member has one vote and there is no system of proxy. In a company, the number of votes depends upon the number of shares and proxies held by the members. There is a limited separation between ownership and management in a cooperative society. Due to limited and local membership, there is divorce between ownership and management in a joint stock company. Okay, so here what they are saying, that key management and control. In case of cooperative society, management is more or less in the hand of members. But in case of joint stock company, it is not in the hand of members. Members, they appoint managers and the managers then run the company. Distribution of surplus. The profit of the company are distributed as dividend in proportion of the capital contributed by the member. So, as far as company is concerned, okay, whatever surplus we have, we distribute in the form of dividend. Okay, and this dividend is based on the contribution of the member. The member who has contributed more will get the more benefit. In a cooperative society, a minimum part of surplus must be set aside as a reserve and for the general welfare of the public. In case of cooperative society, what we do? We put aside some money, okay, for the general welfare of the public. The rest is distributed in accordance with the patronage provided by different members after paying a dividend up to 10% on capital. So, in case of cooperative society, we first give 10% dividend. Okay, 10% dividend is based on the number of shares each person have. Then whatever is balance, it is divided among the members based on their patronage, based on their contribution in the society. So, the person who is more involved in the society will get more benefit. Share capital. Seventh is share capital. In a company, one member can buy any number of shares, but an individual cannot buy more than 10% of the total number of shares or share worth rupees 1000 of a cooperative society. So, what is given? In a company, one member can buy any number of shares. So, as far as company is concerned, a person can buy any number of shares, but an individual cannot buy more than 10% of the total number of share or the share worth rupees 1000 of a cooperative society. So, in case of cooperative society, there is a restriction on the number of shares. One cannot buy more than 10%. Okay. A public company must offer new share to the existing member, while a cooperative society issues new shares generally to increase its membership. Okay. So, here again there is a difference, that if a public company, okay, they wanted to offer new shares, so they first offer these new shares to their existing members. Whereas in case of cooperative society, they offer new shares to get more members. The subscription list of a cooperative society is kept open for new members, whereas the subscription list of the company is closed after the subscription. So in case of a company, the subscription list is closed once it is fully subscribed. But in case of cooperative society, this subscription register is open, means anyone can become member at any time. A company is thus capitalistic in nature, while a cooperative society is socialistic. So here we can say that now the company is capitalistic, that it is formed around activities related with money, okay, whereas so this cooperative society, it is socialistic in nature. Now transferability of the interest. The shares of the public limited company are freely transferable, while the shares of a cooperative society cannot be transferred but can be returned to the society in case a member want to withdraw his membership. So in case of company, we have shares and those shares we can sell to anyone. But in case of cooperative society, we have to return the shares to the company. If we don't want to be a member, we have to return it. A member of the cooperative society can withdraw his capital by giving a notice to the society. A shareholder, on the other hand, cannot demand back his capital from the company until it is winding up. So in case of cooperative society, you can anytime withdraw your membership, you can come out of the company. But the same is not true for cooperative society, and the same is not true for company. Means from company you cannot come out by giving shares back to the company. Okay, if you want to get out of the company, you have to sell those shares to someone else. Coverage. A cooperative society generally draws its membership from a limited local area. So how much area it covers, okay? So in case of cooperative society, the area is limited, your local area, okay? From local area you will make members. The members have a common bond in the form of common occupation or employer or locality. So in case of cooperative society, you will see that the members of the cooperative society are either belonging to some location, are they belonging to some company. A company members have no such relationship and are usually drawn from different parts of the company and even from abroad. So in case of a company, the members are not necessarily that they are from the same occupation, that they are from the same locality, okay. For example, Reliance company is there, okay. Now I can become its member by purchasing a share. At the same time, someone else who is living, say in Dubai, he also can become a member of the Reliance company by purchasing shares. The same is not true for a cooperative society. Exemptions and privileges. A cooperative society enjoys several exemptions and privileges regarding income tax, stamp duty, etc. So benefits. Exemptions and privileges means the benefits are provided by the government. So cooperative society are getting benefits from the government in terms of income tax relief, in terms of they have to pay less or they don't have to pay stamp duty. This is because the government encourages the growth of cooperative undertaking. So why these exemptions and privileges are given to cooperative society? Because government also want that there should be more number of cooperative societies. A public company does not enjoy these exemptions and privileges. So these benefits are not given to the company. Government status. So cooperative undertaking are regulated under the Cooperative Society Act 1912 or a State Cooperative Act. Joint stock company are governed by Companies Act 2013. So there are different laws made by government to run these cooperative societies and companies. So for cooperative society, there is a law, Cooperative Society Act 1912, and to regulate companies, there is a law called Companies Act 2013. Okay, so we have seen the difference between a cooperative society and a joint stock company. We have seen these differences based on their basic objective, their number of members, their members' liability, membership, management and control, distribution of surplus, share capital, transferability of interest, coverage, exemption and privileges, and government status. Now, let us see the same thing in the form of this chart. So, in short, now we are going to see first formation. Okay, so companies, they're formed under Companies Act 2013. The last point, 11th point, what we have seen, government status. So, companies are formed under the Companies Act 2013, whereas the cooperative societies, they are formed under the Societies Act 1912. Regarding number of members, so in company, minimum 2 in private company and 7 in public company. Maximum 200 in private company and no limit in the public company. Whereas for cooperative society, minimum number is 10 and maximum number is no limit on membership if it is a non-credit cooperative society. Management, it is by the board of directors. So in company, you have board of directors. In case of cooperative society, you have a managing committee. Basic objective, what is basic objective? So in company, the basic objective is earning profit. In case of cooperative society, the basic objective is service to the member. Voting right. In case of company, we have one share, one vote. In case of cooperative society, we have one member, one vote. Okay, so in case of company, if a person have more shares, then he has more voting right. Transferability of the shares. So in case of company, it is transferable. We can transfer the shares. In case of cooperative society, not transferable, but returnable to the society. So in case of cooperative society, we cannot transfer our shares to anyone else. But what we can do? We can return it to someone. Return to someone, we can return it to the society. New shares. So new shares are first offered to the existing members for subscription. Okay, so whenever new shares come in the market, in case of company, it is first offered to the existing members. Whereas in case of cooperative society, it is offered to the new members. Distribution of profit. The profit, it is distributed. Okay, after giving dividend, it is distributed to the members based on their involvement in the company. In case of company, it is distributed based in the form of dividend based on their share capital. Privileges. So in case of company, no special exemptions, but in case of cooperative society, special exemptions by the government. Exemptions in income tax. Return of capital. No member can demand back his capital except at the time of winding up. So you cannot demand your capital from the company. It is only when company want to close its business, that time they will return you the capital. In case of cooperative society, member can demand his capital during lifetime of the society. So anytime we can demand our capital. Now, distinction between a cooperative and partnership firm. As we have seen, the difference between a cooperative society and a company. In the same way, we can see the difference between a cooperative society and partnership firm. So, first registration. In cooperative society, registration is compulsory. In partnership firm, it is not compulsory. They can or they cannot. Number of members. So, minimum 10 number in cooperative society, maximum no limit. In case of partnership, minimum 2 and maximum 50. Primary objective. In case of cooperative society, primary objective is to provide service to member. And in case of partnership firm, the primary objective is to earn a profit. Management. In case of cooperative society, there is a executive committee. In case of partnerships, it is the partners who manage. Legal status. Separate legal status is given to cooperative society. In case of partnership, no separate legal status. Government assistance. Government assistance, that is privileges given by the government. So it is available in cooperative society, whereas it is not available in case of partnership firm. And governing law. So for cooperative society, it is the Cooperative Society Act 1912. What is it? It is a Cooperative Society Act 1912. And in case of partnership, we have Partnership Act 1932. Okay, so this is difference between a cooperative society and partnership. We have seen the difference between a cooperative society and partnership, as well as a difference between a cooperative society and a joint stock company. Also, we have seen few merits or few features of the cooperative society. So in this lecture, we have seen the meaning of cooperative society, we have seen features of the cooperative society, we have seen the distinction between company and cooperative society, distinction between joint, distinction between a partnership firm and a cooperative society. So I think we should stop here. So I will stop my lecture here. Thank you for being with me. I hope you understand each topic. Now what I suggest, that either you again go through this lecture, or if you have understood it completely, then you can take some break and then write all these things in short in your notebook, in your own we can say that in your own language, so that you will understand what we talked all about. So what you have to focus, what is the meaning of cooperative society you understood. Okay, it is always better that you write at least one definition also. So we have two, three definitions. Any one definition which you find easy to remember, you can write. Then we have seen the features of cooperative society. The features, there are I think 9 points. So all 9 points you recollect, all 9 points, and you try to write something for each point. Then distinction. So we have seen distinction between joint stock company and cooperative societies. Total 11 points we have discussed. So all 11 points, the main points you should remember, and then you can describe, okay, this point. And finally, we have distinction between a cooperative society and a partnership firm. So there are 7 differences we have seen. These 7 differences you can learn. Okay, so we will see you in the next class. There we will discuss merits of the cooperative society. Merits and demerits, I think. So only merit is, merits and demerits are there. Then we have types of cooperative societies. We have a topic called formation of cooperative society, how a cooperative society is formed. That's it. Okay. So I will see you in next class with all these topics. Thank you again.